Good morning. We are going to stand and open up with This Is Amazing Grace.
Will you please join me in our call to worship and prayer of the day? And this will be read responsively. I will read the parts in light and you will respond with what is in bold. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for Thou art with me. Thy rod and Thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Good Heavenly Father, good Shepherd that has shepherded our souls, Lord, from sin and from death, and into the land of Your eternal life. Father, we come here today and we give You thanksgiving and praise and honor and glory as Your sheep whom You have redeemed, Your sheep that You have called into Your own fold. Father, You have called us out of sin and out of death, Lord, into the realm of Your amazing grace. And Father, there is no way we can repay You for this wonderful gift that You have given us. All we can do is join all creation in singing Your glory, Your praise and honor, and give us our gratitude from the depths of our hearts. Father, as we come here today, we pray that Your Holy Spirit would join with us in praising. Lord, it would open our hearts and minds that as we sing, that we would give You a worthy honor, praise, and glory that You and You alone deserve. And Father, we ask these things in the mighty name of Your Son, our Savior Christ Jesus, and all God's people said, amen.
We are going to remain standing and sing hymn number 464, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Please be seated. Well, good morning. It is nice to see all of you here in the house of our God and King. On this, the day that the Lord has made, let us truly rejoice and be glad in it. For every day that God has given us is truly a gift, and especially the days that we can come into His house with all of our brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus to praise His holy name. I want to welcome you all of you here in the name of our Lord and Savior. We're glad that you've decided to worship with us here on this Sunday morning. If you're a visitor with us, anything that you need to follow along with the service will be printed right here in your bulletin. And if you're watching us either live or later in the day or the week, if you want to follow along with the service, the words will appear on the screen at the right time. But you can also download the bulletin from the comment section of Facebook if you would like to follow along through the bulletin. The few announcements I would like to bring to your attentions, this is being Thanksgiving week. There are some groups we're going to have and some we're not going to have for this week. There's going to be no youth group tonight. You might notice there's not many youth here in church today. That's because most of them have gone up to Camp Fellowship for our fall youth retreat. So because of that, there's going to be no youth group tonight for middle and high school youth. Also, no men's group. Men's group's going to take a Thanksgiving break. So men's group is not going to meet. However, Theology on Tap will continue to meet this week. We meet Monday, 6:30 at Crafty Draft, and we will continue our discussion of mere Christianity. Since Christmas is coming up, y'all know that also means our Christmas cookie sale is happening, and that is kicking off this week. This is a youth fundraiser. This is to make money for their summer mission trip. They're going to be going up to Ohio. Can't remember the name of the town. It's a little suburb outside of Cincinnati, but they're going to serve some people up there in Cincinnati. But they need money to do that, and one way we do that is raising money through the cookie sale. Now, they make fantastic cookies. They make great gifts. You can take them to Christmas parties. The order forms are on the serving opportunities table. Go ahead and grab your form. Get the cookies you want. You can also order the dough. So if you don't want to have the cookies cooked for you, you can order the dough and cook them a little bit later in the month or even the year. It freezes well. Great opportunity. Good way to support and serve the youth. Also need to bring to your attention, we're going to have a congregational meeting next Sunday following worship. This is going to be a very, very brief meeting. We just need to elect our nominating committee. That's already been brought up. So if you think of anybody, though, that you'd like to serve on the nominating committee, we will take nominations as well, but we just need to vote on that very quickly. It will happen very briefly right after worship next week. The women's tree decorating is happening on the 29th of this month at 10:30 at Presbyterian Home. It's a great time to serve as well in this capacity for all women, decorating the Christmas tree at Presbyterian Home. Always a great event. I encourage all ladies to attend the 29th, 10:30 at Presbyterian Home. And speaking of service, we are going to be doing our annual meal kits, a service to Centerville, the families of Centerville Elementary. As y'all have noticed, I'm sure, this last year food costs have gone up quite a bit. And it's a struggle for a lot of families. I'm talking to you as a family, from a family of six. I can't believe how much food costs now than it did compared to a year or 2 years ago. Of course, this burden always falls harder on the poorest members of our society. And I know it's a struggle for me and my wife to continue, because of course we got a lot of teenagers, of course, but I know it's a struggle for us. I can't imagine how much some of these other families are struggling right now to put food on the table. This is always an opportunity for us to show the love of Christ. So we're going to, like we did last year, putting together some food kits for some needy families in our area for Christmas. There is a list you'll find out here of what we need y'all to do. We're asking you to sign up to make a food kit. And there's a list here of all the things that we need. We're probably going to get the meat provided for some way, but we're asking you to get things like box of potatoes, green beans, baked beans, and to get these kits and to put them together. We've actually signed up for 45 families this year. I know it's a lot, but there is a lot of need in our community, and I know we can do it. And just open your hearts and your generosity. When we share, we always find out we have more, and we have more than we ever imagined, ever more than we knew. I think this year, more than previous years, this is going to make more of an impact for these families that really need it this season. So there's a sign-up sheet out there. Look at your budget, see what you can do, give what you can. And I think the Lord's going to respond in a great way. Looking forward to this. So Centerville families are helping them out. And finally, speaking of missions, we got a Costa Rica trip we're going to be taking next summer, and now is the time to buy tickets. If you've signed up for the Costa Rica mission trip, Laura has told me, and she is an extensive traveler. I don't think anyone has gotten more miles traveling across this country than she does. She knows what she's talking about. She tells me the tickets are probably not going to get cheaper now, cheaper than they are now. So now is the time to get your tickets. Talk to Laura for our Costa Rican mission trip this summer. And now I think that is all the announcements I have. So with no other announcements, I would like to invite the children of the church to come forward and join Jenny here in front of the baptismal font for our moment for children.
Wow, we got a big crowd this morning. Welcome. Come on, have a seat. He's not sure about that. Next time. Well, welcome, gentlemen. It's nice to see y'all here this morning. How's everybody?
Good.
Good. What's going on this week?
Thanksgiving.
Yeah. Who likes Thanksgiving? Everybody. Turkey. Grayson likes it too. So, do y'all know the story of Thanksgiving, I'm sure. We shared a meal with the Indians, right? We changed his mind. I got a surprise if you want to come up. So, Thanksgiving is a special holiday, and we have a lot of traditions on Thanksgiving, like eating turkey or getting together with our family, or, yes, giving. We're getting to that. Hold your thought. So one of the traditions, I'd never heard of this before until I was trying to get ready for y'all's talk this morning. It's called the five kernels of corn. Have y'all heard of that? I hadn't either. You haven't heard that? Well, this is kind of a different thing. So it's an old tradition, I'm told. On your empty plates before Thanksgiving, when you have your plates set, people used to put five kernels of corn on each plate before they start, before they got their food. And before they ate, they would give five reasons they were thankful. So it's a good thing to help remind us when food was scarce, or even now it's still scarce with groceries like they are, and how God provides for our needs. Our Bible verse for today is from Psalms, and it says, "Let them give thanks to the Lord for his unfailing love and his wonderful deeds for men." So this morning, guess what I've got for y'all? No turkey. I've got more candy. This is candy corn for y'all. I want y'all to try to put out, don't eat it yet, okay? Put out five kernels of corn. I don't know how many people y'all are going to have at your Thanksgiving table, but maybe you can share if you have to. I think, can your little brother have one or not? He's too, is he? Your little brother, I'm sorry. Can he eat candy corn? Take another one. Take one for him. You can tell me. Okay, so what are y'all going to do? You're not going to eat it yet, right?
Yeah, I'm going to eat
it. No, you're not. You're going to save it, and on Thanksgiving, you're going to kind of run your people who you're with on Thanksgiving through this exercise and explain to them five kernels of corn. We each give five reasons we're thankful, okay? All right, now you know what I'm going to ask y'all to do?
Eat it.
No. I'm asking you to not eat it. I'm going to ask you to kind of warm up on this Thanksgiving stuff, okay? I want each of you, I'm going to go around. I want you to give me one thing you're thankful for, okay? I'll start. I get to do two because I'm doing the teaching. So my first is Carolina beat Tennessee last night. Okay, but on a more serious note, I'm very thankful to be here this morning to be able to worship and to talk with you guys, okay? All right, Scott, since you're all over the thankfulness, what's your one thing?
I'm thankful for food.
Water. Grayson? Oh, well, you got lots of things to be thankful for. What's something good? Can't think of anything? All right, well, think on it. You got it? Church, yes. We're all thankful for church.
Cousins.
Huh? Cousins. Oh, y'all are good cousins. What'd you say?
Shelter.
Yes. Lots of,
Family.
Lots of things to be thankful for, right? And even on a bad day, we've still got lots of things to be thankful for. So we'll try to remember that. All right. Thank you guys for listening. Do not eat your candy. Hold it for Thanksgiving. Let's try to do our five kernels of corn. Now, we ready to pray? Okay. Dear God, thank you for providing for all our needs and for loving us. Help us to remember there's always something to be thankful for. Watch over us this week and over the holiday. We love you. Amen.
I think we were eating candy corn.
And brushing your teeth. Remember my last time.
Thank you for that message, and it's important for us to be vigilant about the Thanksgiving because the world wants to skip over Thanksgiving. I mean, you notice as soon as Halloween comes, the Christmas decorations go out, and it's not just skipping one holiday for another holiday. They want to skip the Thanksgiving part and go right to the celebration and the giving gifts and getting stuff. But we can't do that. We have to remember the Thanksgiving first, and it's for good reason that Thanksgiving opens up our season of celebration for Christmas and New Year's, because it all begins with giving thanks, and we can't forget that. As soon as we forget that, we lose all of our perspective. And one of the greatest things, of course, we have to be thankful for is God's forgiveness. It's His grace, because it makes us thankful for everything else, makes us able to enjoy everything else. The fact that while we were still sinners, while we were still enemies of God, that Christ died for us, and God gave us His grace and our forgiveness that we might have new life. Our part in this is to come to God and confess our sins. And to confess our sins and to repent. And then just simply receive His grace and forgiveness. So friends, let us come and confess our sins together. First in quiet meditation in our hearts and to God alone. And then together as it's printed in the bulletin. Let us pray. And now together, just and holy God, You have made us a holy people and set us aside for a holy calling to comfort Your people and gather the lost to You. Yet the world around us cries out in pain and we refuse to hear. The lost pass us by on the streets and we turn our heads and go our own way. Your commands fall on deaf ears, and Your statutes on unwilling hearts. You ask, "Whom shall I send?" And we remain silent. Forgive us, merciful God, and grant us hearts for Your people. Send us, we pray, to the wounded and the lost, to those who wander in darkness, and those who do not know Your name. May we be Your people, doing Your will, abiding in Your grace, and living with the heart of a servant. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen. Friends, who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. I declare to you, in the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
We will now stand and sing "It Is Well With My Soul." And just a note that we're going to sing verses 2 and 3 back to back.
Sorrow like sea billows.
Please be seated. For our scripture passage today, we're going to continue looking at Peter's first letter. And we've called this the travel guide for exiles. Because in this letter, Peter is giving us our advice and how that we should live as exiles of God. As in, we're living here in this world where we don't truly belong, as we're waiting for Christ to come and for all of his promises to be revealed to us and for us to find our true home, our true place, and even our true time. Before we begin, let us pause for a moment in prayer. Good and glorious Father, you have given us your Spirit to guide us and to direct us and to shepherd our steps. And Lord, you have given us this holy word, your own scripture, written and inspired by your Holy Spirit. And Father, these truths that are embedded in here can only be revealed, we know, if that same Spirit that inspired these words would guide us still today. So we ask, Lord, that Spirit be upon our minds to instruct us, to teach us, to open our minds to the truth that you have revealed here to us. Father, bless this holy reading of your holy word, and may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I want you to imagine with me, if you would, for a moment, that you are the owner of this rare and beautiful vineyard. It's a 100 acres of choice grape-growing land, these beautiful rolling hills, these nice, abundant vines that are just heavy with fruit every year. And what's even better about this vineyard, because of the grapes that are grown there and the particular type of earth and the climate you have, that every year this produces a grape that's unlike any other in the world. It's a one-of-a-kind grape. You can't get it anywhere else. And so if you harvest this grape and you make wine out of it, it produces this vintage that you can't get anywhere else. All right, it is unique, and it's lovely, and it's wonderful. So imagine for me, you've got this vineyard, and it produces these grapes that produces this unique wine. And you're going to give this vineyard to a friend. You're giving 100 acres of this choice grape wine producing vineyard. You're going to just give it to a friend of yours. And you tell this friend, listen, I'm going to give it to you free and clear. This is yours. I've only got two conditions. Two conditions, right? I want you to use it well. Take this vineyard, use it well. And the second condition is make sure people know that I gave it to you. That's it. It's yours. Yours to produce, to do what you want with it. Just use it well. And let people know that I gave it to you. All right, so imagine you've done this. You've got this choice wine-producing vineyard, and you've given it to a friend with only these two conditions. And let's say you come back 10 years later, and you see that the whole farm has fallen in disrepair, that weeds are growing up between the vines, the trellises are rotting, and they're falling apart. Some of the vines themselves have even died from lack of care and nutrition, and that the only grapes that are produced are these small, almost half-diseased things. And you can take one look at this vineyard and you can tell this friend that you gave it to has done nothing with it at all. What would your reaction be? What would your thoughts be about this? What would some words be that come to your mind when thinking about this friend who has taken your gift and done nothing with it? Probably ungrateful would be one of the first words that came to mind. Wasteful, that'd be another one. You look and say that they squandered this great opportunity to do something wonderful. Another way of putting it is that they were not good stewards of what was given to them. They were given this wonderful gift, and they were not good stewards of the gift that they were given. In our passage today, the apostle Peter talks about us being good stewards of the grace we were given. In this passage, he tells us to be good stewards, he says, of the varied grace that God has given you. And in fact, he's given us several kinds of grace that he's given us and poured into our hearts. And this gift of grace is like a priceless treasure that's placed in our hands. It's just like this vineyard that I described to you a few moments ago. It is something priceless, it's unique, and yet it can produce something wonderful if we put just a little bit of work and effort into it. And God has given us these gifts. He has given us this grace, this priceless grace, and he's only asked two things from us: put this to good use and give me the credit and the glory and the honor for this grace that I have given you. So he's given all of this treasure. All of this, all of us, this priceless treasure. And the question we have to ask is, what have we done with it? He's given us the gift of grace and the gift of salvation. Have you used it well? So that's what Peter is talking about here in this part of his letter, being stewards of the grace that he has given us. He starts out right here in verse 1. He says, "Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God." So here, right here, what Peter's doing, he's recalling to us the grace that God has given us. Christ has suffered in the flesh, and that is how we received our forgiveness, and that is how we received our grace, because Christ has suffered in the flesh for us. So what that means for us now, our suffering in the flesh has new meaning. Or you could probably say our suffering in the flesh now has meaning. Because without the suffering of Christ, our suffering in the flesh is meaningless. Whatever suffering it is, whether it's this, the aches and pains of old age, of getting sick, of getting injured, of being oppressed by injustice or crime, or just think of any kind of suffering you go through, it's pointless suffering if Christ didn't first suffer. Without Christ, without an eternal life, without God here looking over us and shepherding this world, all of our suffering is meaningless. But now that Christ has suffered and we've been given this grace, what happens first is now our suffering means something. Now our suffering has a purpose. Now there's something that comes out of this instead of just awful, plain, meaningless suffering. Now something good can come out of it. And when he says the first thing that good that comes out of us is now that we can be free from the passions and now serve the will of God, is to no longer, as he says, no longer live the rest of the time in the flesh for human passions. But now we can live our time in the flesh for the will of God. Now, when he says human passions, he's talking about these desires and these urges of the body. And they're not bad. In and of themselves, these passions are not bad. We need things like hunger. That shows us we need food. We need urges like thirst. It tells the body it's time to drink. We even need the urges of our sexuality because, well, if you don't like to think about it, that's how we all got here. Okay, these passions, they're not bad in and of themselves. It's when we're ruled by the passions that they become evil. It's when these passions rule over us and they direct us and move us and tell us what to do, that's when those passions become evil. It's when we use these passions or seek them out in a way that God has not intended to, in a way that God has forbidden us from seeking them out, that's when the passions become bad. That's when these passions become evil. But he says, because of Christ's suffering and through your suffering, you're now free from having these passions. Not of having the passions, sorry, but being ruled over by them. We've been given this freedom. Our sin is no longer telling us what to do. Now we are free to decide. It's the grace of God that has done this. It's the grace of God that has freed us from these things so we don't have to live like we're animals anymore, ruled over by our passions and our desires and urges. I mean, you think about your dog, no matter how much you love your dog, how great that dog is, they're ruled by passions and urges. I don't care how well you've trained the dog, if you put food on the floor and walk out of the room, eventually that dog is going to eat the food because he's a dog. That's what they do. They're ruled by passions and urges, but we have been freed for them, so now we can live for the will of God, not the will of the flesh, not the will of our passions. He goes on to say this in verse 3, "For the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. With respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debaucheries, and they malign you, but they will give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead." So he gives and he lists all these things that you were slave to if you're a slave to your passions, if your passions rule over your life. And these are the things that we've been liberated from. Can we fall back in them? Sure. Can we stumble back in them? Sure we can. And we do. Only difference is now you're free to choose. Now you're free to repent when you mess up. Now you have the strength to lift yourself up when you go wrong, inevitably, as we all do. And it's grace that's given you this opportunity. It is grace that has given you this gift, first of your freedom and your liberation. And Peter urges you, this is a gift. Use it well. This is a gift of grace. Steward it as it is meant to be used. And so Peter then starts to lay out, how do we steward this grace? How do we live now under grace and not under the dominion of our passions? And he begins in verse 7. He says, "The end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers." It's the first way we steward our grace that God has given us. Be self-controlled and sober-minded. Okay, another way of saying it is to have discipline. Okay, that's how we control ourselves. That's how we get to tell ourselves what to do and what not to do. And as soon as you're free from those passions and freed in Christ, now we get that self-control that we don't have any other way. Now we have been able to have this opportunity for freedom. Because you think without self-control, without any of that self-discipline, we just run after, well, whatever desire comes in our head. Oh, this looks good. I'll go for that. Oh, I like this one now. I'm going to go for that. Oh, well, this one looks better today. And we're just bouncing around in our life with no direction, with no purpose, with no control. Without self-control, the possibility of discernment is impossible. Without self-control, we can't even ask the question, is this a good idea for my life? Is this something that I should be doing? Is this something that I should be engaging in? You've got to have self-control even to begin to ask that questions, to make the choices, to choose the right over the wrong, to steward the grace God has given you. You first need self-control. And if you sit back and think about it, if you don't have self-control, then who does have control? If you're not controlling yourself, who is controlling you? Because if you don't have self-control, someone or something else is the one calling the shots in your life. And when that happens, it's usually, almost always, not in your best interest. So self-control, first way we steward the grace God has given us, self-control. The next way, looking at verse 8, above all, keep loving one another earnestly, since love covers a multitude of sins. This one is no surprise, right? The way we steward grace is we love one another. Love is the law. Love is the essence of God's character. Love is the essence of grace itself. It's because of love that God gave us grace. It's because of love that He forgave us and gave us all these second and third and fourth and thousandth chance that we get at life to be good people. It's because of love He's done that, so it makes sense that the best way to steward that grace and to show the gratitude for that grace is to love one another. So it's the same love that God has given us to all of our brothers and sisters, to our neighbor, even to our enemy. And notice it says love earnestly. Right? It says love earnestly. That means love for real. No fake love. No just show love. No just saying you love. Okay, you can't say bless your heart and then talk about them behind their back. All right? Earnest love. And it comes with this beautiful assurance. It says, because love covers a multitude of sins. I mean, that's a great comfort because, I mean, we can't ever make up for our sins, right? We can't earn our salvation. It says, but if we can even come close to doing that, it's by loving one another. It says love covers a multitude. It says it doesn't cover all your sins. You can love and you're going to still need Jesus, but it can cover some sins and it can cover even a lot. Peter says a multitude of sins. If there's any way we can come close to balancing the ledger of our sins or having some of them stricken off our record by our own effort, it's only through love. Only through love. It can cover a lot of your sins, a whole multitude. Not all, but a lot. And of course, when he says love, it doesn't mean just your kids or your friends or your family or the people you like. We have to remember what Christ told us. We have to love our neighbor, no matter how annoying our neighbor might be. We even have to love our enemy. Great way to steward your grace. Love one another. And then he says this in verse 9, show hospitality to one another without grumbling. Show hospitality to one another without grumbling. Here is another great way to steward your grace. Because hospitality itself is kind of a model for grace. You invite a stranger or someone else into your home, and you give them the seat of honor, you entertain them, you feed them, you give them something to drink, you give them a place to stay, you don't make them clean anything up. I mean, it's just a great way to, I mean, that is the model of grace itself, because God gave us all these things that we have without us earning them, without us deserving them. And so in hospitality, we're able to show a little bit of that in the same way. Invite a visitor, even a stranger, someone you don't know, into your house, and you give them out of your abundance. I mean, what a great way to show grace. And of course, he says you have to do it without grumbling, right? Give hospitality without grumbling. Right? That means, oh man, you see what Rob did? He ate all the potato salad. And he eats so much every time he comes to visit. He never offers to clean the dishes. I wouldn't make him do it anyway, but at least he should offer, shouldn't he? Now that kind of ruins the gift if you complain about it. Right? You give hospitality without grumbling, without complaining about what it costs you. Because God has given you everything that we have without cost to us. And you should give it for no other reason. Is this a good Southern virtue, right? Hospitality is what us Southerners are supposed to be known for. And then finally, in stewarding the grace, he says this in verse 10. He says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks as one who speaks oracles of God, whoever serves as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. So Peter says, use your gifts to serve one another. Use your gifts to serve one another. He says, you've all been given what he calls a varied grace, as God has given you his varied grace. Now, varied means different, as in there's this grace that he has given to us in a different way. Now, there's three kinds of grace that I can identify throughout Scripture. Now, the first one's common grace. That's the grace given to every human being on this planet. Every human being receives the common grace of God, a blessing, right? They receive certain gifts. Every human being is God and is part of God's common grace. Then there's saving grace. And saving grace is for God's elect. It's the grace that leads to salvation. And then finally, there's this what he calls varied grace. And varied grace is just like it sounds, is that everyone doesn't get the exact same type of grace. Right? It varies from person to person, from gift to gift, from individual to individual. And we've all been given this kind of grace in a different way. Some people have been given this grace as a gift of music. Some a gift of teaching, some a gift of administration, Some have been given this varied grace as a gift that they're really good at working with people. Some have this varied grace as a gift of healing. Some with building and working with their hands. Others in finance who've been given it as a grace to make money. I wonder what that's like. It must be nice. But we've been given a gift. You have been given a gift of God's varied grace, which means it's a unique gift. Other people might have a gift that's similar to it, or maybe even with the same name, but it's not exactly like the grace that God has given you. He's given you a grace, this very grace that is yours and yours alone. It's part of the relationship you have with God, and no one else is a part of it. It's one of the things that makes you a unique creation in our Lord. And there's a purpose behind the gift. There's a reason He is giving you that varied grace. Now, it's not uncommon that when we have a gift, what we do is we go make a living with it, right? God has given us His gift and His talent, and we go out and we find a job that fits that gift or talent, and we make money with it. Some people make a whole lot of money with it, and that's fine. That's okay. That's one of the good uses that you should use God's gift for, but that's not the only one. It is perfectly fine to take your gifts and to go make a living and to make money on it. But if that's the only thing you do with your gift, then you're not fulfilling its purpose. And what I mean by that is the reason God has given you your gift is to make a living, but that is not the purpose He has given you that gift for. It's okay to make a living with it. It's okay to make money with it, but that's not the only thing you should be doing with your gift. I'll give you back to verse 10, because he says, as each has received a gift, what does he say to do with it? Use it to serve one another. That's why he's giving you your gift, is to serve one another. If you're only making money with your gift, you're not using it like it's supposed to be used. God gave you this gift to serve one another, and he also, if it says here in verse 11, it says, he's given you this gift in order that in everything God may be glorified. To serve one another with your gift and to glorify God with your gift. That's why he gave it to you. He's given you this good in your heart. You're supposed to take this good and you share this good with other people. Whatever it is, the good or the gift he's given you, and he has given you one, you're supposed to take it and you're supposed to share it with other people. You're supposed to take it and you're supposed to glorify God with the gifts he's been given you. And if all you're doing is making a living with it, if all you're doing is making money, you're not using it like it's supposed to be used. Your gift is to serve others and it's to glorify God. Now, you might be wondering, where can I use my gift to serve others and glorify God? Is there such a place where I can go and use my unique gifts to serve others and glorify God? Well, if you're asking that question, I am so glad you asked it. Because there is a place that has been designed by God specifically for you to use your gifts to serve others and to glorify God. It's called the church. And we've got a way for you to use your gift to both serve others and glorify God. We have ministries we've designed specifically for that purpose, and you can sign up for them anytime you like and serve for as long as you desire. And if you're wondering to yourself, well, I'm not sure where my gift fits in, come talk to me. We will figure it out. As a pastor friend of mine, I used to like to always say, God loves you, and I have a plan for your life. Welcome to Cherokee. So the question we all must ask ourselves is, what have you done with the grace that God has given you? Now, I'm not saying that you've got to go out and earn your salvation, because you can't do that. And I'm not asking you this to you to make you feel guilty. Well, maybe a little bit. I'm not throwing this out here to try to say you got to go out and prove yourself to God. You've got to go do some mighty act to attract attention so God will see just how obedient you are. I'm just saying, take your gift and use it in obedience and gratitude. Think back to that field, that vineyard we talked about at the beginning. That if you gave it to another person and you saw it fall into disuse, how would you feel about that gift? I'm willing to bet you would have thought you wasted that gift on a person who didn't use it for its intended purpose. Friends, let's be stewards of God's grace. Let's be stewards and use it well. He has given us this priceless gift, and He's given it us that we can love one another. He's given you a unique gift so you can use it to serve one another and to glorify the name of your Savior. Now, if you're keeping track in your books and your little passports, our bit of advice for today from Peter is be stewards of God's grace. Or rather, be good stewards of God's grace. To steward that grace is to serve one another in gratitude and joy. To steward that grace is to bring honor and glory to the one who gave it to you. To make your life a service to others. To make your life a song of praise to God. For there is no better use of His amazing grace, and there is no greater meaning to your life. To Him be the glory and the dominion forever and ever. Amen. Friends, will you pray with me? Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe. Father, we come to you today as the receivers of your varied grace, as receivers of your saving grace, as receivers, Lord, of the common grace that you have given to us all. Father, we have to admit that we don't always use this grace well. Lord, days, sometimes weeks and months might go by where we don't even think about the enormity of this gift you've given us. And not a moment sometimes will entertain our minds where we even think for a second about how we can use this to serve others and to serve you and to glorify your name. But Father, we know that in your grace there is forgiveness for that also. And so we ask today, Lord, for the grace of your Spirit to always remind us and keep before our minds and our understanding the great gift you have given us. Father, help us to remember that we are children and, Lord, even slaves to your grace. And that everything we have is due to that grace you have given us, and everything we are is due to that grace that you have given us as well. Help us, Lord, to find ways that we can steward this grace well. Help us, Lord, to find ways that we can use this treasure you have put in our hands and multiply it and to serve others and to bring glory to your name. Help us to think, Lord, first and foremost, in how it serves you instead of how it serves ourself. So I pray, Lord, you give us those hearts of a servant, that heart of humility, and a heart of trust in you, Lord. Father, so we labor and we know that sometimes we struggle to use our gifts, but we see no fruit in our life. So we help, Lord, to trust you, to know that if we give our life to you, if we give our service to you, Father, it will bear an eternal fruit, though we don't see it, nor do we always understand. Listen, receivers of your grace, Lord, that we turn and lift this world up to you and pray your blessing and peace, and your prayers be with it. We pray for, Lord, those who suffer and those who are lost, for those who wander in darkness, Lord, for those who do not know your name, for those that are stuck in a cycle, Lord, of pointless suffering. We pray the mercy of your grace and your salvation and your promise be upon their hearts. Father, we pray for all those that have suffered this week from violence. Father, we lift up to you the people from the University of Idaho, For those University of Virginia, for those, Lord, that are in Colorado Springs that have just suffered senseless violence, and Father, we pray just a healing and a blessing and a strength upon them as they grieve and as they struggle and as they search through meaning in this. Father, we pray for all those who need healing. And we lift up to you Charles and Heather and Brenda and Nell and Aria. And we pray, Lord, just a strength and mercy upon their bodies. Father, we lift up for all those that grieve. Lord, we lift up the foster family who is going through a new loss right now. And for Jackie, Lord, who is just transitioning to a difficult period in life. And we pray your special grace and be upon them in that moment. Father, we pray for our families and for our children. And pray that you would guard us and direct us and shepherd them, Lord, as they seek meaning and their purpose and their way through life. Father, we also remember the great blessings you have given us. And Father, we thank you for Peepsy and just the wonderful many years you have given her today, Lord. And we pray many more years upon her and many more blessings. And in her, we are reminded of the great grace that you have given us. And Father, we lift up to you our unspoken prayers right now. And I pray, Lord, that you would hear the cries of the hearts of the people here today. And we lift all these prayers up in the name of your Son, our Savior, Christ Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. My friends, our God has given us grace in many, many forms. And one way he has shown us this grace is the provision he has given us through our financial gifts. And to be good stewards of this gift is to give back to him a small portion of the great abundance that he has blessed us with in order that this abundance might serve others and glorify his name. If you would like to give here at Cherokee Presbyterian, there are many ways that you can give. We have offering plates on either side of the sanctuary's door as you leave. And you can also give through Venmo, PayPal, ACH Bank Draft, or United States Postal Service. And we thank you for all the ways that you support the work and ministry here at Cherokee Presbyterian. And now in response of thanksgiving for all that God has given us, let us stand and sing together our response of thanksgiving. Let us pray. Good Heavenly Father, we bring these gifts to you, and we pray, Father, that in them that we are good stewards of all the abundance that you have blessed us with. We give you these gifts, and we pray that you would bless both the gift and the giver, and all that we bring to you today would be used for the advancements of your kingdom until your Son returns to us again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And now we're going to continue standing and say what it is we believe using the words of the Apostles' Creed. Friends, what is it you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We are going to remain standing and sing Build My Life.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Build my life upon.
Go now as stewards of God's amazing and varied grace, serving one another and giving glory to your heavenly Father. And now may the peace of Christ, which surpasses all understanding, be with you and guard your hearts and fill you with God's blessing. Amen.